So, Aigo, last time we saw that different receptors were existing, and now we can study the distribution of these receptors. So, we have several techniques, in fact. Either you are looking at the mRNA, and in that case, if you exactly want to see the mRNA in the tissue, you will use in situ hybridization, not hybridization, but hybridization. You can also use something like quantitative RT-PCR or RT-PCR. So you take a piece of tissue and then you do transcriptase reverse transcriptase, sorry, and then polymerase chain reaction. But here you cannot see in the tissue. You take the tissue and look at the number of mRNA or the if the mRNA is present. And the last technique would be something like a northern blot, where you take the tissue, you destroy it, and you make the mRNA migrate on a gel. So in that case, you can have the quantity of mRNA and whether it is present or not. Again, you don't see the mRNA in the tissue. But I think you know, you all know in situ hybridization. Then you have immunohistochemistry, and I think also you all know the immunohistochemistry, where you can see using antibodies the distribution of one receptor, one enzyme eventually, and what can it be also? Transporters, for instance. And then we have quantitative autoradiography, which is less used nowadays because it is using radiolabeled compound. So I switch here on the location of D1 and D2 receptors. This is just an example of what we can expect here with immunohistochemistry. So the authors of this paper used antibodies directed against D1 receptor. Of D1 and D2 receptors is in the striatum, and look also at the situation in the Niagara, pars reticulata, a huge labeling of D1 receptors, and a huge labeling of D2 receptors, but here in the substantia nigra, pars compacta. So you can play with different techniques to propose or to understand a scenario on which kind of cell could express those receptors. So if you are looking at the immunohistochemistry, the immunohistochemistry tell you that in the striatum, you have a dense labeling in the for D1 receptors. In the substantia nigra pars compacta, you have zero labeling. And in the substantia nigra pars reticulata, you have a dense labeling, but you can see at the image. And for D2 receptors, a huge labeling in the striatum, dense labeling, a dense labeling in the substantia nigra pars compacta, and modest but present labeling in the substantia nigra pars reticulata that you can appreciate here. So if you look at D1 receptors, but now if you do other with mRNA, so inside to hybridization, then you can see that in the striatum you will have the presence of the mRNA, but not in the SNR. While the protein is present in both the striatum and the SNR, as shown here. So it means that the D1 that we can see in the SNR is not expressed locally, but comes from another territory. And so you could do experiment to destroy striatal cells, and you will see destruction of this labeling as well. So it means that the striatal cells going to the substantia nigra pars reticulata export address D1 receptors to the terminals of the striatonigral pathway. So with different techniques, you can appreciate the labeling, where the address the receptors and from which kind of cells. So on the next slide, I would like to recall something which is weird with respect to the dopamine innervation in the brain. So you have the localization of the mRNA for dopamine receptors. So I think this is in French. Anyway, this is mRNA for D1 in rat and humans. So you are somehow learning French. Human, homme. D3 in rat and human, D4 rat human, and D5 rat and human. And the distribution of the receptor in different brain regions. So you have ganglion de la base, which means basal ganglia, and you have the caudate putamen and the nucleus accumbens. Caudate putamen and nucleus accumbens. And you can see that the mRNA for D1 and D2 receptors is largely expressed in the striatum, I mean caudate putamen, and the nucleus accumbens, here a little bit less in human for the D2 receptor, and largely more for D3 receptors. In humans, at least, but you have a huge density of D3 receptors in rat and humans. Then D4 receptors, this is quite low, and D5 receptors, as far as I know, you have almost nothing. So these are all data, 2004, and I think recent data reports some expression of D5 in some cells of the striatum, but this is anyway not very dense. So you have a huge dopamine innervation, but you see you have D1, D2, D3, and less or no D4 and D5. If you are looking at the hippocampus, where gyrus, dentate gyrus or hippocampus, then you see a little bit of D1, D2, D3, and interestingly, D4 and D5. So this is interesting because this is where, in the hippocampus, you have almost the dopamine innervation is really, really, really sparse. And then you have D4 and D5 receptor, which have a better affinity for dopamine compared to D1 and D2. And finally, you have also the expression of mRNA for D2 receptors in the substantia nigra or the ventral tegmental area. For D2, I think they completely missed something, but I don't know, because in the ventral tegmental area and the substantia nigra pars compacta, this is where you can find the autoreceptors, see the mRNA, and they did not see mRNA for D2 receptors in the ventral tegmental area in humans. So I think, anyway, so this is just an example, and I don't want you to, I don't know, to learn this. And if at the exam you have something like this, you will have the document to discuss this. So this is not really important, but look at the sort of mismatch you can see, for instance, poor dopamine innervation in the hippocampus, and still you have some receptor mRNA. For 5-HT1A receptors, I think, did I show you that? No, maybe not. So they used radiolabeled compound and did autoradiographic quantitative studies with two ligands, one 8-hydroxy-DPAT and the other one WEI-10635. So just look at this labeling. You see a strong labeling in the lateral septum, dense labeling in the cerebral cortex, and almost nothing in the striatum. So it means that this labeling for 5-HT1A receptors is heterogeneous in the brain. So in the anterior part, but in the medial part of the brain, you can see a strong labeling in the hippocampus, still modest dense labeling in the cortex, denser in the basal cortex here, also a little bit in the amygdala, and the thalamus here, but essentially the medial part. And then if you look at posterior part of the brain, at the level of the dorsal raphe nucleus, so this is in between the mesencephalon and pontic region, you can see a strong, still dense labeling in the cortex and a strong labeling in the entorhinal cortex, so the basal cortex here. You saw? A little bit in the hippocampus, and a particular labeling which is important in the dorsal raphe nucleus and the median raphe nucleus. Dorsal raphe nucleus here and the median raphe nucleus here. And I have to speak about that So first, H-hydroxy-DP80. Do we have the same labeling with the other compound, which is maybe a little bit more selective, way 106-35, and which is basically an antagonist in contrast to 8-hydroxy-DP80. And in fact, those two ligands label almost in the same way the parts in the brain. So you have the same labeling. So this is nice. And you can see the heterogeneity of the distribution of 5-HT1A receptors in the brain with these compounds. This is important, the level of the dorsal raphe nucleus or median raphe nucleus, it corresponds to the autoreceptors. So those 5-HT1A receptors that are produced by serotonin cells themselves. So on the right side of the slide, I wrote lesion. And just to tell you that we can destroy serotonergic cells in the dorsal raphe nucleus or and the median raphe nucleus with a specific toxin, which is 5,7-dihydroxytryptamine. And when you inject this toxin directly by surgical stereotaxic procedure, you can remove serotonergic cells. So you could also destroy cells in the raphe using kainic acid to do exocytotic lesion of the cells in the raphe nuclei. So do electrolytic lesion of the raphe nucleus just by lowering an electrode, then you put high current, for instance 3 milliamps for 1 or 2 minutes, and then you remove your electrode and you have no longer tissue in the dorsal raphe nucleus. So this is another way. And if you are doing the labeling hydroxy-DP80 or WAY-135 or immunohistochemistry or in situ hybridization, in all cases with those approach, lesioning approach, lose the labeling for 5-HT1A receptors only raphe nuclei. So at the end, maybe serotonergic cells are responsible for this specific labeling. And interestingly, you have no consequences on the labeling of 5-HT1A receptors in other parts of the brain, which means that if you are doing in situ hybridization, you will have a labeling which will be similar to the labeling of the protein. Usually the 5-HT1A is produced and addressed at the cell bodies and dendrites of neurons. It is rarely addressed at terminals of neurons. So you have the labeling of 5-HT2A receptors here, but I already spoke about that, and especially to evoke the situation of the non-specific labeling, which is present here. And I told you at that time that maybe it is better to use M109-07 to label 5-HT2A receptors because when you are doing non-specific study, you don't see something. So which means that probably this ligand labels only 5-HT2A receptors. In contrast, ketanserin is inducing the same sort, the same kind of labeling, especially in the cortex, but you have something in the caudate putamen, which is remaining when you are doing a non-specific binding with a compound in excess. And I told you that we know why there is a remaining part, especially in the striatum, but this is true also in the other brain regions, but especially in the striatum, because ketanserin is labeling the tetrabenazine site or the vesicular transporter for monoamines, VMAT2. So if you look closely to the picture in B prime, you could see remaining labeling in the striatum, which is strong and which corresponds to dopaminergic terminals, but you can see also remaining labeling in other parts of the brain, and of course you have monoamines in other parts of the brain. The density is lower, but you have still VMAT2 in other parts of the brain, so that you have a remaining labeling for the non-specific binding. So anyway, what is the message here in terms of our topic? The message is, for instance, a serotonin 2A receptors is mainly expressed in cortical fields. So you have a huge expression in the insular cortex and a dense expression in the frontal cortex. So you have, I draw here a table for all serotonin receptors. So this is a sort of review of their distribution. Again, you don't have to know that. The only message is all these receptors have their specific distribution. For instance, 5-HT1A receptors, this is mainly the limbic system with, as we saw, hippocampus, lateral septum, etc., and as autoreceptor in the dorsal raphe nucleus and median raphe nucleus. 5-HT1B, mainly the extrapyramidal system and the basal ganglia. So expressed in the striatum and addressed. It's like D1 receptors, by the way, in the substantia nigra, but I think cells in the substantia nigra, if I remember correctly, don't express 5-HT1B receptors. Receptors is in the NAMs from including the striatum and hippocampus. So 5-HT1, but see, it is less known, this is the striatum. 1F would be rather the area post-rema, the amygdala, olfactive tubercule, yes, and also spinal cord. You have also on the intestine, but this is not the brain. 5-HT4 receptors present in quite high density in hippocampus, striatum, and accumbens, olfactive tubercule, substance nigra, and VTA. So somehow, hippocampus apart, this is close to dopaminergic neurons. 5-HT5AB, cortex, hippocampus, abenula, cerebellum. 6, the striatum, accumbens, and 7, hypothalamus, thalamus, and cortex. So you see, this is different for all 5-HT receptors. Now, targets are pre- and postsynaptic, and I will speak now about the autoreceptors. The autoreceptors, this is a receptor which is expressed by a cell and which is involved in the homologous control of the activity of the neuron. So it means that the neuron is releasing the neurotransmitter, and then it acts, the neurotransmitter acts back on the act in inhibitory manner. But I can show you some examples for glutamate. I spoke about that, I think, where it could be sometimes excitatory. Anyway, the autoreceptors for monoamines are usually inhibitory, and you have the situation for D2 receptors expressed by dopaminergic neurons, alpha-2 receptors expressed by noradrenergic neurons, and 5-HT1A/1B receptors expressed by serotonergic neurons. Their localization for D2 and alpha-2 is both at the soma, dendrites, and terminals, while in case of serotonin receptor, 5-HT1A receptors, which are equally addressed at the level of cell bodies in the raphe nuclei, while 5-HT1B receptors at terminals, far, far, far away. Those receptors, as we have seen, are also expressed in the other part of the brain. So please understand that if I'm an asset, we have autoreceptors and receptors. Function of the photoreceptors, as I told you, this is to participate to the homologous control of the activity of the neuron. So usually we think about the action potential, and this is what I will speak about. Don't forget that because the enzymes involved in biosynthesis are in the cytoplasm and they are regulated, then the action of the neurotransmitter on autoreceptors could also act by modulating the activity of synthesis, either enhancing or lowering the activity of synthesis. So I did not speak about H3 receptors, but H3 receptors are the autoreceptors for histamine. So I report here the autoreceptors 5-HT1A, D2, alpha 2, H3, and at terminals 5-HT1B, D2, alpha 2, and H3. So you have action potentials. Then you have release at terminals, but also release at the level of cell bodies. And the consequence is an inhibitory effect of the autoreceptor on the firing frequency of the neuron. So basically, if you inject an agonist, a 5-HT1A agonist, for instance, you will reduce the firing frequency of the neuron. I can mimic to you, or for instance, a D2 agonist. I will mimic it. You will remember till the end of your life. So, not yet, but be sure it comes. For instance, here you have the example using intracerebral microdialysis, where microdialysis probe has been inserted into the striatum. So the dopamine, which is expressed as percent of basal values with respect to samples collected here each 20 minutes, the microdialysis probe has been inserted into the striatum. And here, the purpose of this time course of effect of Quimperol is to determine the action of this D2 agonist on striatal dopamine release in vivo. As you can see, in saline treated rats, this is the white round cycles, the release of dopamine is quite stable for the entire period of monitoring. Then the authors inject a small quantity of Quimperol. It was peripheral administration. And then they saw already at 10 microgram per kilogram, so 0.01 milligram per kilogram, they already saw a small decrease and significant decrease of dopamine release, reaching almost a maximum at 0.1, 1, and 3 milligram per kilogram. So as a pharmacologist, for other experiments, I would use, for instance, a dose of 0.1. This is a nice characterization, a dose-dependent effect. And because you... So I like to show you this, because without this, you never know where you are. And in pharmacology, do dose response and then discuss or adapt. So as a pharmacologist, I would do some experiments if I have to characterize this effect with 0.1. 0.1 being the dose reaching almost a maximal effect, which is not too high, and which avoiding non-selective effect. When you are at 3 milligram per kilogram, okay, you have the maximal effect, but you never know whether you recruit some other stupid binding sites. Anyway, now I will mimic what could occur on the firing rate of dopaminergic neurons. So you are recording the firing rate of dopaminergic neurons using a glass capillary inserted at the level of the substantia nigra pars compacta or the VTA. And then you are close to one neuron which present a discharge, and you can amplify the sound that you are recording. And then you will inject Quimperol. So it can give you something like that. This is a sound of, can be regular, sometimes irregular, but the frequency of discharge is around 4 hertz. So I'm not sure I'm as fast as this. And then you inject Quimperol. And after some time, you go back. So you can record and listen, this is impressive, the neurons responding to the stimulation of autoreceptors. So is it only autoreceptors? Honestly, don't exactly know. We can also imagine the participation of receptors in the striatum expressed by GABAergic neurons and then going back to the substantia nigra. But at least if you directly inject Quimperol or other D2 agonists in the substantia nigra or the VTA, you can stimulate autoreceptors and reduce the firing activity of dopaminergic neurons. So I would like now to speak about the inactivation. So here you have two images. So, by the way, inactivation, I will speak about some activation, but you understood that autoreceptors can be a sort of process of inactivation. But you see, I will speak about something a little bit. here, this is a catabolizing inactivation and the non-catabolizing. So I report here some images, but for almost nothing, just for your convenience, with the organization of the protein of the transport of the DAT, dopamine transporter, with 12 transmembrane segments. And here the labeling in humans using Evans C cocaine as radio tracer for on emission tomography and showing you a strong labeling in the caudate putamen. But in fact, the labeling is almost everywhere. So I will speak about something else. First inactivation, so I call this one number one because it is involved in almost all monoamines and it uses a cofactor FAD to oxidize or eventually reduce aldehyde. But to usually you start with your monoamine and you oxidize, monoamines by monoamine oxidase, which are famous under the word MEO, the abbreviation MAO. So you have two types, monoamine MAOA, monoamine oxidase A, and MAOB, monoamine oxidase B. It was found that iproniazid had some benefit on humor, specifically blocking MAO enzyme. And nowadays we have some compounds which are specific, for instance, clorgiline for MAOA, but this is an irreversible binding like iproniazid, while moclobemide is an inhibitor, but a reversible inhibitor. So it can block the enzyme and then go back and to be removed from the enzyme, while the other one are irreversible inhibitors. So we have clorgiline as a good ligand for and good inhibitor for MAO, and we have deprenyl, which is a good inhibitor for MAOB. So if you are working on MAO, maybe as a pharmacologist, I will ask for data or confirmation with clorgiline for MAOA or deprenyl for MAOB. What are the substrates of MAOA and MAOB? Noradrenaline for MAOA and adrenaline. You have also dopamine and, curiously, serotonin, but serotonin has a good affinity, but so we don't exactly know, by the way, how it works. And MAOB, this is for dopamine, but this is also MAOA. And honestly, people think that this is MAOB, but when I inject deprenyl or other inhibitor of MAOB, I can tell you that this is far from to be evident that MAOB are involved in the catabolism of basal dopamine, so forget it. That's clear, forget it. Don't break your legs for this. You have MAOA, MAOB. As far as I know, MAOA is more involved in the catabolism of monoamines, while MAOB, I cannot discard it. Sometimes it's minimal participation, but think that you have a lot of circulating amines, and that amines are potentially noxious compounds. So you have in the body a lot of proteins that are used for detoxification. For instance, the cytochrome P450, and I ask for some works on this because I want to highlight this important point in your culture, pharmacology. You have those enzymes which are detoxifying some xenobiotics and some endogenous ligands because they are potentially noxious. And this is a case of amines. Not only most you know them, but also other amines like spermine or I don't know, you have a lot of different amines. Yes, and maybe you have some polyamines also that could be transformed by monoamines oxidase. I don't know. Anyway, monoamine oxidase are not only involved in the metabolism of noradrenaline, serotonin, dopamine, or something else. And I would draw your attention of this in the chemical reaction that you can see over there, an amine which is transformed by monoamine oxidase in what? In aldehyde. So aldehyde are even more reactive compared to amines. So this species is really dangerous. You see, ROH. So it means that after this reaction, you have the active participation of aldehyde dehydrogenase. So, MAOA and MAOB have been studied for their distribution in the brain, and MAOA is present, the total expression of MAOA in the body present in periphery compared to the brain, where we are estimating that we found 20% of its total representation in the body. This is in contrast with MAOB, but you will understand why MAOB is expressed by glial cells. So it is highly represented in the brain. So it is expressed by glial cells and serotonergic cells and histamine cells. But the contribution of these two small circuits is negligible compared to the expression of MAOB in glial cells, which constitute the main cells in the brain. So MAOA is more expressed by cells in the locus ceruleus, probably substantia nigra, I don't know, and sympathetic ganglia. Of note, dopamine has similar affinity for MAOA and MAOB, in contrast to, for instance, serotonin. Serotonin, which has a really bad affinity for MAOB, and look that essentially serotonin cells are expressing MAOB, but MAOB has a real bad affinity for serotonin, while MAOA has a better affinity for serotonin. So there is a second inactivation catabolizing reaction, but in that case, this is specific for catecholamines. And it is called catechol or methyl transferase, COMT. So specific for catecholamines because the substrate are the catecholamines, noradrenaline, dopamine, and probably adrenaline. We know some inhibitors, entocapone and tolcapone, which can be used in as a complement in the treatment of Parkinson's disease. Again, like the inhibitor, the peripheral inhibitor of the decarboxylase, it is to enhance the availability of L-DOPA to penetrate the brain. So this is to avoid the metabolization of L-DOPA at periphery. So we know that if we give L-DOPA by pills, we will generate some sort of, modified by COMT, and it will give 3-methyl L-DOPA. And to avoid this, entocapon is an interesting compound that can limit at periphery the transformation of L-DOPA into 3-methyl L-DOPA. So at the end, and if we forget one step each time, here is a catabolizing action on dopamine. So dopamine via monoamine oxidase plus aldehyde deshydrogenase gives DOPAC. And then DOPAC is transformed by COMT into homovanillic acid. So here I took something from German, and this is in German, but this is HVA. And dopamine can also be transformed by catecholomethyltransferase, COMT, which gives 3-methoxytyramine, 3-MT, and 3-methoxytyramine can be first oxidized to give an aldehyde, and then processed by aldehyde dehydrogenase to give the final product of the catabolization of dopamine, which is HVA. HVA is the final product that we pee. So in your toilet, you have HVA. So similar for noradrenaline, you have different pathways due to the involvement of monoamine oxidase and catecholomethyltransferase. And then you have the participation of aldehyde deshydrogenase, the COMT also at this step, and also sometimes aldehyde reductase. In any case, aldehyde are not good at all for the cells. So you have a lot of distinct compounds in the metabolic pathways of these amines. So be aware of that, and don't learn by ear this kind of enzymatic pathway, because they are region dependent. So it depends on the region. So prefer to be shy on this part, but be aware that you have several enzymes involved in the catabolism of the of these enzymes. Now, the non-catabolizing inactivation, and I would say first the also homologous control, because we are speaking about transporters that are specifically expressed by the cell releasing the neurotransmitter and reuptake. So, for instance, the DAT is specifically expressed by dopamine cells, the NET by noradrenergic cells, and the SERT by serotonergic cells. The composition of amino acid is quite similar. It can be regulated, and you have different sites of glycosylation at extracellular sites. And you have also a different number according to the transporter considered. Phosphorylation sites, so 5 for DAT, 1 for NET, and 8 for SERT. And in fact, the SERT is probably more regulated compared to the other transporters. So the distribution of the mRNA, because it is expressed, and this is a sort of homologous control, because it is expressed by its own neuron, that will be seen for the mRNA in the substantia nigra de VTA, NET in the locus ceruleus, and the SERT in the dorsal raphe nucleus and the median raphe. For the proteins, you will see that in the striatum and the nucleus accumbens. Forget the hippocampus, the cortex, amygdala. The labeling is quite low with immunohistochemistry or autoradiographic studies. For the NET, everywhere, and for the SERT, everywhere. Except that in the striatum, not stratum, but in the striatum, faible means weak, very weak, faint labeling. So, again, don't think that because it is called NET, that it will specifically reuptake noradrenaline. If you look at the affinity of the DAT, NET, and SERT for noradrenaline, dopamine, and serotonin, you see that noradrenaline has low affinity but still affinity for the DAT, a better affinity for the NET, and no affinity for the SERT. Okay, so you have preference for the NET, but don't exclude reuptake through the DAT. And my message here is more clearer for dopamine. Dopamine has the same affinity for the DAT and the NET. And we now know and acknowledge the fact that dopamine can be reuptake by the NET in regions where the DAT is not expressed or poorly expressed, such as the cortex, the hippocampus, amygdala, maybe amygdala, but at least the cortex, this is known. Extracellular dopamine is reuptake by the NET. And a lower affinity for the SERT, but I can tell you that sometimes you can see dopamine inside serotonergic cells. And so it means that sometimes you can go to 6 micromolar or even less, maybe 1 micromolar is sufficient. And serotonin has a low affinity for dopamine uptake sites. Dopamine transporter, I mean, for noradrenaline transporter, but still we know that serotonin in some condition can enter dopamine cells via the DAT, and it has a very good affinity for the CERT. So here, this is quite logical. Now you can study the distribution of these transporters. So this is everywhere for the CERT, etc. You can destroy the monoaminergic cells with 5-7-dihydroxytryptamine or 6-hydroxydopamine. You know that, and then you can see that each case you are lowering the labeling of these transporters, which means that those transporters are expressed by monoamine cells and their respective neurotransmitter. Then you have some pharmacology with diamphetamine or cocaine, which are well known. Diamphetamine has a good affinity for DAT and NET and a low affinity for the CERT. And when you look at the affinity for cocaine to the distinct transporters, it has a similar affinity for all transporters. So you cannot exclude the NET and the CERT in the mechanism of action of cocaine. Here you have the IC, so the inhibition constant 50, for distinct antidepressant drugs for the reuptake, because here they study the reuptake of serotonin on synaptosomes expressing the CERT, the reuptake of noradrenaline for synaptosome where the NET is expressed, and synaptosome for the entry of dopamine where the DAT is expressed. So each time you can generate a concentration response curve of the entry of, for instance, serotonin inside synaptosome or terminals of neurons, and you can block this with the compounds that are listed in the left part of the slide. And you can study the IC50 for each compound and for each transporter. So you can see that sertraline, which by the way is a serotonin selective reuptake inhibitor, block with high affinity the transport, the entry of serotonin with IC50 inferior to nanomolar. So its KD should be close to or below 1 nanomolar. And it has less affinity for noradrenaline and dopamine. And in fact, this is 100 times better affinity for serotonin transport compared to dopamine, almost 100 times better affinity. Paroxetine also, although this is a 50 times better affinity for serotonin compared to noradrenaline, and 100 times, yes, compared to dopamine. Clomipramine, this is not considered as a SSRI, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor. This is considered as a tricyclic compound. And as tricyclic compound, it has affinity for serotonin and noradrenaline reuptake sites and very low affinity for dopamine reuptake sites. So citalopram, maybe this is a okay, I'm waiting a little bit because there is a problem with the video conference in Marrakech. So this is for the PowerPoint. Okay. Marrakesh is back.
Thank you, teacher.
So I was on this slide, which this is not a sexy slide, you know. It's a lot of numbers, etc., etc. But at the end, this is quite simple. And I would like to show you that citalopram is really SSRI, because it is selective for serotonin reuptake sites compared to noradrenaline and dopamine. And now I would like to draw your attention to fluoxetine, Prozac, which is the first serotonin selective reuptake inhibitor. So maybe it has a better affinity for the CERT or the NET, but if you are looking at pharmacology, dynamic pharmacology, and the entry of serotonin or the entry of noradrenaline, then you can see that it blocks the transport of serotonin and noradrenaline with a similar affinity. So this is not my understanding of selectivity. Okay? So you have now imipramine, amitriptyline, and desipramine, which have similar affinity for the CERT and the NET, even a better affinity for the NET in the case of desipramine. In all cases, the DAT is probably not participating to the antidepressant effect of these antidepressant drugs. There is one antidepressant drugs, but this is unclear. There is one antidepressant drugs which can display an affinity for dopamine. It is dopamine uptake sites, and it is called bupropion. Bupropion. But because it has some affinity for dopamine uptake sites, there is some sort of side effects with bupropion. Can be agitation and addiction. So it has to be carefully used in clinic. So it has been also proposed as anti-addictive drugs because the potential of developing an addiction is quite low. So it can disrupt some addiction to drugs, but some patients are developing some addictive behavior. So it is not evident to use. So, what is the consequence of blocking the transporters? Here, I go to the slide, effect of cocaine on dopamine release. This is quite intuitive. If you impair the reuptake of the neurotransmitter, then the neurotransmitter stay in the extracellular space, so you are increasing the extracellular concentration of the monoamine. For instance, here, these are results corresponding to the injection of cocaine at time zero at different doses, 10 milligrams, 15 milligrams, 30 milligrams in the nucleus accumbens and the striatum. Okay, and the effects are compared to the vehicle of cocaine. So here, don't worry, there were two vehicles, but because it was coupled to another drug, and it was a vehicle of the other drug. But here, just consider the legend here, vehicle, cocaine 10, cocaine 15, and cocaine 30 milligrams. So all these doses are behaviorally impacting the animals. So softly, with an increase in locomotor activity at 10 and 15 milligrams, and less softly at 30 milligrams, because they are starting to move everywhere with repetitive behavior that we call stereotype behavior. So what is the effect here? You increase and you have the maximal effect when you inject cocaine with intraperitoneal injection, and you can reach almost 500% of baseline, little bit less, 400%. In both regions, 400% means four times already, which is enormous. Then a little bit more at 10, and then at 30, this is more than 20 times more the basal levels, which is indeed enormous. So this is not a non-exocytotic release, because if you remove calcium ions before injecting cocaine, you prevent the effect of cocaine. So it needs exocytotic release to be expressed. There is also something else participating in the uptake of monoamines. And this, honestly, we are going to the old days. Old days. I was not even born, so maybe you were not born either. In the 50s and 60s, where indeed people found uptake with high affinity, and it was indeed the DAT, NET, and CERT. We found them later. But they found also a second uptake. In terms of enzymology, it was clear there was something at low affinity, 10 times lower affinity. And nowadays, we know that several transporters are capable of reuptake monoamines, and for instance, you have organic carbocation transporters, OCT1, OCT2, and OCT3, some of them being present in the brain, and I think this is the case at least of OCT3, which is represented here. You have a labeling here, so don't look clearly at this labeling, but you can see that in the hippocampus in A, you have important labeling. You have important labeling also in the cortex. So I think I give you here argument from a paper showing that OCT3 is present in various parts of the brain in diffuse manner. So it could eventually reuptake the monoamines. And we know that they can reuptake monoamines. But what I would like to add is that indeed, they don't have a high affinity for monoamines. But the speed of the transport of monoamines is 10 times higher compared to the DAT, the CERT, or the NET. So once it opens, it fastly reuptake neurotransmitters. So you have 10 times lower affinity, but 10 times higher efficacy. On this amazing the inactivation processes. And be sure that be part of this and be the neurotransmitter released in the synapse. So if you are serotonin, your fate is the following. You are in the synaptic cleft, then, how can I say, diffusing in extrasynaptic space, and then you are reuptake by the CERT with high affinity, but low speed. And you can be reuptake by OCT transporter, and there is another one also, PMAT. PMAT is PMAT, yes, plasma lemnal monoamine transporter. So this is quite clear. PMAT has low affinity for monoamines, but high speed of transport. So you have OCT1, OCT2, OCT3, PMAT at least. So you see at the end, we are not so far from the situation of glutamatergic or GABAergic systems where we have some transporters that are specifically expressed by presynaptic terminals and which corresponds to homologous control. And transporters that are elsewhere and which are expressed by other cells. So if you have serotonin, CERT, and OCT with less affinity, but high speed of reuptake. And then you are here and you are destroyed by MAO and MAO by pre- and postsynaptic sites. If you are dopamine you can be reuptake by the dat with high affinity, the net with high affinity, and OCT1, OCT2, OCT3, and PEMAT. Then you are destroyed by monoamine oxidase, presynaptic and postsynaptic. And finally, you can be destroyed by the COMT, but the COMT is not expressed in, I think, in the extracellular space. This is a mistake. COMT is expressed in postsynaptic cells. Anyway, this is not really important, but this is more catabolizing, so dependent of ATP, etc., etc., so more inside the cell. And then you, if you are noradrenaline, you can be reuptake by NET. Eventually, the DAT, if the concentration increase, but eventually by the DAT with the same affinity compared to OCT1, 2, and 3.